Love is hard enough to speak about at the best of times, but to speak about it in a societal or political context is especially disconcerting for me. Still, I have come to believe that if this kind of very basic love is completely absent from political and community discourse, we are in trouble. I'm not advocating boundless affection between those who have been deadly enemies very recently. I'm merely suggesting that if there is no will to truly understand, truly reflect on, truly listen to the experience and feeling of people we don't like, then we are doomed to reproduce our antipathies. Expressions of what I'm calling love could be very modest indeed. They could, as I've said, involve no more than paying genuine attention to someone. Too often in this part of the world, listening has meant nothing more than waiting your own turn to dive in. I was born and spent my childhood in Newcastle, County Down, though maybe I don't belong there anymore. But it was there that I learned to write, and I came to love writing. I saw things going on around me as a boy, and I felt things which were very heavy, so I wrote these down. I put them down, like weights, though I didn't know anyone who wrote, and didn't even know you were allowed to. This is where I had my first kiss, you know, the first one that actually worked, and I could say, oh yes, that's what it's all about. Anytime I'm in the town, my hometown, I would come here and I'd be a sucker for doing something like that. And I think that's the right word, you know, I come to the place and I suck the memory, suck the goodness out of it. But you know, I think just today and the last time I was here that maybe there's nothing in this spot anymore. Maybe I've sucked everything out of it. Often people turn away from art and they turn away from writing. They think it's got nothing to do with them because it doesn't touch them. And what I want to do more than anything else is to touch people. I don't really want to impress anybody because nobody really likes being impressed. You know, you might come out of an exhibition or something and say, that was impressive. And to me, that's pale. You're not being got at in the crevices of your heart and your joy and your sadness and that kind of thing. And it seems to me that we should be making noises, making sounds that could resonate in any human heart. Before I write anything, I would walk all around it. I would go out, I would clean every shoe in the house, I would do things, anything but the writing. And the reason for that is once I begin to write anything, I'm committed to that. I'm committed to trying to be as clear and distinct in my articulation as I possibly can be. Before I start on any big piece of writing, I sit down and think to myself, actually, I can't do this. The point is, I was never able to do it. I got away with it in that play or that bit of verse, but I know I can't do this. But then what happens is you start to write and the writing itself settles you down. And then I just love it. I get lifted up by it and hopefully then there's a chance that other people will get lifted up by it too. I know this wouldn't be important to everybody who does the kind of things that I do, but it's important to me that there's a relationship between the domestic and the artistic, you know, that I never just get too far away from the real world in my writing or just as a human being. And I know that there's one view of artists, you know, that they should make their own rules and they should be out there and they should be living everything to the full and firing about and all that kind of thing. And I used to believe that, and I used to do that when I was at college myself, and I had this idea that, you know, I was some kind of a literary alcoholic hero in the making, you know, but then the writing, being a wee bit wiser than me, started talking back to me and said, well, actually, you're a pathetic, slobbering mess, fully formed, you know. But when I'm doing the ironing or when I'm, you know, doing the groceries or whatever it might be, I often am away with the fairies in my head, you know, and like I play a lot of music whenever I'm at this kind of thing. Like, it just takes me away, you know. Sometimes I think I was born the wrong colour, you know. I would love to have been one of those, in one of those groups where you're doing the steps and wearing the big orange frilly shirt and all that kind of stuff in the 70s. I think of writers as being perched in the circumference of whatever circle we're in. You're watching people all the time. You're on the trail of humanity, sitting, looking, listening for clues. I think it's useful to have some people who kind of sit on the bank of the river, stilled, and they reflect on what they see going by. Because I think too often our lives go by us, or we live our lives as if we're in a train, you know, and we notice the odd thing out the window of the train, but we don't have time to be still and to dream and to wonder. And I think a lot of people just kind of batten down the hatches and say, well, that's the way it is, and you just get on with it. But I think if you do that, you can't break open each moment that you're living in. You know, like breaking open an egg and take the goodness and the vitality out of that. And you get out of touch with your own living, you know. You don't actually live your own life. It's something that passes you by, and then you get to 70 years of age and you sit by the fire someday and you look across and you see somebody sitting there beside you and you think, geez, Mary and St. Joseph, how did I get here, you know? Or is there anybody out there? And the nice thing about writing in a public way as a job, and this is positive, you know, I don't want to get too kind of heavy in this, is that you put all these things out and you ask, is there anybody out there? And you're trying to make connections. And then somebody comes to your play or somebody reads your poem and they come back to you and say, yes. Yes, I'm out here.
My most recent play, Loved Ones, is an attempt to give voice to some of the hurts of the troubles, to make the grief available.
People don't know how much a bomb destroys. They don't know about the loneliness. That's the killer. I can go for days without talking to a living soul, but that's not a thing you can take out and show to someone. Tommy and I meet like the two sides in a hotel. He gives me money. and I make his meals. If I didn't have Mark to talk to, I think I'd go off my head. People think that it's a jump, that grief is a big high jump, that you practice for months and years maybe, and then you get over it. And you think maybe they're right. And you practice, till you find out that someone keeps raising the bar on you.
The way I see it is that, you know, all of these things that people are doing are making clearances, you know, spaces in which, down the line a wee bit, other things can happen. You know, people talked immediately after the ceasefire about enormous things. Forgiveness, acknowledgement of the hurts that you have done, you know, things like that, which are huge and which, you know, we're not going to flip over from one thing to the other like that. But if the more spaces that are made, the more clearances that are made, I think anyway, the more things can take root and happen.
And I think like it's like a double-edged sword in a sense, you know, because we've got to, it's people can use language very, very easily, but not actually be tapping into the sincerity or the wholeness of what it's supposed to represent.
Like, to be perfectly honest with you, when I was listening to people, some of whom are here tonight, you know, and I don't think that we covered ourselves in glory, to put it as mildly as that, in the time of the Troubles. I think too many of us, too many writers and artists and so on, found a kind of scenic route that we could take through an awful lot of horror. And by taking that scenic route, I think we were diminished. And then, you know, Linda sits and talks to her son and says to him, do you know, I stay here because I can miss you. If I'm alive, I can miss you. That's my only reason for living, is missing you, you know.
Do you know what was the very hardest thing of all to bear? The thought that I was nobody's mother anymore. Nobody's. And it's true. I'm not. I'm nobody's mother now. I remember sitting in the church at his funeral thinking, I am a mother without children. A stupid, stupid thing. That's what I am. A stupid, stupid thing.
I think everybody's very aware that there's an awful lot of aggression, you know, out there in the world at the minute, and sometimes I think that any creative act, you know, any positive act is very vulnerable, you know, it can be destroyed very easily. But I think the important thing to remember, especially in this part of the world now, is that once a thing like that's done, it stays done. You know, the spirit of the thing can't be destroyed.
There's a lot of indestructible work being done by community groups all over the north. I take part in this by working with writing groups, up to 100 in any year. It takes me away from home, but the crack is priceless.
Greatest kiss every day of the week. We an awful lot of people in writing groups write poetry. And I realised that writing poetry is a very bloody odd thing to do. You know, to write statements or feelings down in these truncated lines is actually very odd. And some people say, oh, poetry is wonderful, poetry is sacred, poetry is the highest form of language and all that. I think poetry has to earn its keep. And what I mean by that is people who read your poems have to think that it has something to do with them. And for too much of the time, contemporary poetry actually doesn't have anything to do with them. It has such a narrow focus that it's like needlepoint. And I don't want to, I mean, needlepoint's grand, but I don't want to engage in that. So I have to ask myself and then ask people in writing groups, why would you do this? Why would you do this strange thing, writing in these short lines with particular assonance and rhyming schemes and all that? And the answer that I come up with is because it makes music. If you set yourself these limits or these disciplines of line lengths and form and so on, it can work like a hose, you know. It can put the fluid of your imagination, if you like, under pressure. And when it works, what comes out is music. Faster than fairies, faster than witches, bridges and houses, hedges and ditches, and charging along like troops in a battle, all through the meadows, the horses and cattle, all of the sights of the hill and the plain, flying as thick as driving rain, and ever again, in the wink of an eye, painted stations whistle by. What do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's really...
It's
the simplest little poem. And it's the sound of a train. And a very simple little device that you could use is break the rhythm. You know, start off with da-da-da-da-da-da-dum, da-da-da-da-da-dum, da-da-da-da-da-dum, da-dum. Da-dum. Do you know what I mean? Because that then gives a ragged edge to the piece. I said to you, like, you have to sing it if it's a poem. But if you're just going deedly dee 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 dee, and then he died on me. You know, it doesn't make... Yeah, it just slips down people's throats before they know it, you know. So that's another wee simple way of relating the form to the content. If you're writing about something that was a bit sad or a bit hard to take, tear the edge off it, you know, and leave it the way life is, if you like, incomplete, broken, with a bit of a jagged edge to it, you know? Okay, but I mean, I don't want to talk...
If there is something rattling around inside you, whoever you are...
Who they are, I don't want
...that to... is causing you a bit of concern or worry, or that is pulsing away in you, it is never good to just let that stay in the pressure cooker, to just let that stew away.
What would you change? I suppose I could say to be free and single again, to have no squabbling children, especially teenagers, who seem to...
It's always useful to take the thing from the inside to the outside and call it by a name. In fact, I think that if you keep that inside, that it does you damage, that it does you harm, and that it actually does the people around you harm as well.
My father was alive. My father died when I was 32 years old, and in all those years, I never told him I loved him. So if I was given the chance, I would tell him just the way I should have many years ago. Apart from that, as the old song says, if I had my life to live over again, I'd still do the same things again.
It's more important than writing. To me, it's a kind of health issue that people feel confident enough to walk the earth and to make their relationships and to do whatever it is the business of their particular life, that they just feel entitled to do that. That they don't live their lives like some little drop of water that is diminishing all the time until it's nothing, until it's evaporated away. I try to say to people, you can do anything. Anything can happen through you as long as you're open to it and as long as you leave the valve open. Don't feel earthbound. Don't feel hidebound. Don't feel circumscribed by people around you who might be trying to cut you down to size. Take wing.
Once I had the blues because I had no shoes, till I walked upon the street and found a man with no feet. A quote from a man who's obviously been here too, who also took for granted the life in me and you. From our Father in supreme love came 400 million choices, 400 million pairs of eyes, ears and legs and voices. Searching for the other half, they all gave up and died. You're the one who won that race, gaining rights to grow inside. Protected in your mother's womb, till growing time was through, what happened was a miracle. The miracle was you. We were not made at a careless whim in the laboratory of life. We're a manifestation of God-given love, a creation of husband and wife. You cannot improve on a miracle. Accept it for how it will be. When you look in the mirror, the reflection that's there is the one-off of you and of me. When I look at the things that are beautiful, the things that never shall die, I'll never be worthless, never be nothing. I'm someone and something, I'm I. Look forward to today, not tomorrow. Leave regrets and mistakes to the past. We only have now, it's here to be lived. You're the playwright, the world is your cast.
That is nice, isn't it?
It's nice.
I think that my most immediate, truly creative work is rearing two children. It's not, you know, kind of building this wonderful edifice of my own reputation. It really is the rearing of two children in such a way that they will feel at home in the world. Because sometimes their father doesn't, you know. And that, again, would be another reason why I write, to try and heal, you know, some of my own brokenness. But sometimes I say to myself, if only I put the energy into them, into playing with them, into listening to them, into being the same size as them, as I do into making plays and poems and all, it would make a lot more sense.
I worry, as someone who likes to be still, that the world my children inherit will be too full of speed. I worry about the world where the market is seen as an absolute moral force, where water is in private hands and time is money. I know my kids will have to cross the information superhighway and hope, in my ignorance, that nothing will knock them down.
So this is the chat here.
Mm-hmm.
Hey folks, what's happening? Howdy, Mupper. Nada.
Yeah, I walked in, my name's Mupper, and I said hi all. And then these are people coming back saying, hi, Mupper. All the rest.
It's like a language that the native does not know, isn't it?
Yeah, it does take a bit of getting used to sometimes.
In Wibble.
Yes, that's a whisper. Someone called Pookie has whispered to me, so only I can hear that. He's telling me he's on the channel Wibble, I think.
Right.
Yep, he is indeed.
Do you speak in a sort of, in this kind of, not Star Trek, but this kind of cut down language, is it?
Yes,
it's not,
it
hello,
tends
how
to.
Are you doing?
It's
Damien here.
Or? For speed, you know, you right. Could type U instead of U. So instead of writing Y-O-U, you can type U or R.
Right.
Yes. Hi, Mupper, how are you today?
LOL. Jesus. What does that mean?
Laughs out loud.
Oh, laughs out loud, right. Well, that's a bit more fine. How are you doing?
What worries me about the superhighway is that you meet no one on the highway. You overtake them, you're overtaken, but everyone's self-contained. You never touch.
I think maybe my generation is the first to have a very particular problem, which is that we find it hard to dream beyond television. beyond the adverts on television. The visual imagery and imagination of advertising is so powerful that I think a lot of us find it hard to dream beyond that. I mean, myself, like when I was 14 or 15 and looking for a kiss, you know, actively, desperately seeking a kiss, I wanted it to be like the Du Bonnet advert. I wanted one of those kisses that had the music and the configuration of light and all and people and of the Du Bonnet advert. So one of my ambitions is to speak about things that aren't often spoken about or people find difficult to speak about, like love. I love you even is, it's worn away, you know, it's almost meaningless now. So one of the things I would like to do in the long term is find a way of writing about things like love and dreaming and romance in a language that was up to it. You know, to find, to discover a language for love. Loving people is one thing. Accepting love is another thing. And I think really that that's when the test comes. Like, you can love all around you. You can love inanimate things, you can love paintings. But to accept into your heart the love of another person, you have to open to them, you have to be vulnerable to them. So I wrote this poem about that, which is called The Solipsist, and the solipsist is somebody who thinks they're the only person on the planet. Everybody else is just a kind of audio-visual aid. So this is a poem about all of that. From my island to your mainland home, I call across this water that I love you. And this is only wise. Of course I do. For you bring me all the things that I cannot grow. But you call back to say you love me too. And this defeats me. What is here for you? Perhaps the winters charm you for a time. Or have you redevelopments in mind? For I have not the bravery to know that you might say it just because it's so. There's a woman who runs a newspaper kiosk in Belfast who keeps an eye on things that I do on the TV and the radio and that. And I had said that poem one time and she'd heard it. And I met her the next day and she said, I heard your thing last night, you know, when I was saying oh yes and kind of preening myself decently for a compliment. And she said, I really like that one, you know, the one about the chiropodist. So I was thinking to myself afterwards, well, there you are, you know, you do this poem and you think it's about receiving love and all that and the difficulties of that, and there's a woman who thinks it's about somebody who looks after your feet, and yet she still gets something out of it. So it doesn't really doesn't belong to you anymore when you put it out there. What did I really like coming up now in a minute? And this is a real bit coming up now. I live for a wee minute, so that was brilliant.